minun kertomaan, eli nimi on Tapani Purjonpahdus Nokko, kaikki tämän esiin, niin kertomaan vähän niin kuin tästä Suomen näkökulmasta. Ja, I think that our guest wish that we have it in English, let's try it, have it in English, and we'll have that, and if needed, jump to the Finnish in certain parts, but otherwise. So that some experience that how we have worked in Finland towards the European norm, and what have taken place, where we are, and what kind of questions, challenges we have met or considered, and also try to take a look, a little bit look for the future, the way forward. Even the European norm is now in place, that there is also years to come and some new developments, I believe. The current situation in Finland from the directive implementation point of view into the local law, we have executed from the beginning of April this year the local law for the e-invoicing directive, and there was work done in a work group last year from spring, and then the law was going to the parliament in December, and I think it was accepted the second round in February, and I'm now executed from the 1st of April. A couple of remarks concerning the implementation of the European norm. Finnish State Treasury and Central Government units are capable to proceed on the control. That's the basic fact. So that in Finland the Central Government uses the service providers, so that it means that the service provider have to be capable of process the European norm syntaxes, and then governmental units are still going or continue to process the mostly Finvoice messages. But from the point of view that the suppliers see, they can send whenever the European norm content syntaxes to the Finnish central government. Other public sector organizations shall be capable to proceed EU non-contents invoices from 1st of April 2020. So that's in the local law, that there is that period the transition period for the local government, or let us say not the local government but public sector that is governed by the law. In that sense. And in Finland we have gone beyond the basic directive in a sense that the law states also that all P2P and P2G buyers have right to require EU non-compliant invoices from the 1st of April 2020. And that is important thing, to boost the usage of the European norm and e-invoicing in general, because it's a mandate. There is no any kind of penalties known, but it's in the law. And then it of course means that if one of the suppliers is not willing to do it, then it's always possible to prosecute, but there is no any penalty setting in the law. And this is different from the point of view that we have already in our VAT, local VAT law, that has earlier said that every buyer have right to get an invoice. But now we have a statement in this law that every buyer have right to get electronic invoice in EU non-contact. anything questions on this or something to add?
We go below the threshold.
Yeah, that's one thing. So the law concerns also the below the threshold, so that it's much wider. If we go for the threshold, then the actual impact of the law is quite minimal, because the threshold is so high. So that it's really aimed to boost the inputs. Okay, and we have a public sector implementation guide or SIUS, as we learn. At least it's also published in the CEF pages as a SIUS, but it's available in the State Treasury web pages, the implementation guide. And there have been earlier as well the implementation guides for the e-invoice content called the minimum content requirement, but now it's more comprehensive and related and reflect also the EU law and its content. And that implementation guide, I made it simple, but there are three main parts it defines. First is the EU mandatory content. So that what is coming from the basic EU norm and those mandatory elements coming from there. Then there are certain mandatory elements and content coming from the used syntaxes in Finland, the Finnish and the Saxon. Not that many, but anyway, there are those. And finally, there is also a list of mandatory contents when buyer has given data requirement to seller to be included in the invoice. So that it means that the Finnish public sector buyer can define when doing the contract or when doing the trade that certain content shall be included in the invoice and it's agreed on by. Local e-invoice message syntax support for EU norm in Finland. In Finland we are using all Finnish people know that mainly the two syntaxes, the Finvoice and TEAPS-XML. What is your feeling that when now we are in a situation that the EU norm came in place as a law, should we have already gone for the EU norm syntax from the 1st of April this year? Or should we continue for time being with our local syntax? Just your feeling. No opinions.
I have
one. Did
My old hat and new hat, but we thought it as a bank sector.
Yeah.
We noticed that only changing syntax or format doesn't change so much.
Yeah.
But if we really want to go further, we should go to PEPPOL and implement all that add-ons what they are coming for addressing it there.
Mm-hmm.
And then the time was too short. We couldn't do it.
Yeah.
I think so.
It's a time constraint.
Yeah.
Let's put it the question a little bit different way. How many of you or who of you think about that after some transition period, 3 years, something like that, we should transform ourselves from our local syntaxes into the EU norm?
I started to think earlier during this day that
I present the company.
Yeah.
And I started to think about those issues also, because we are changing our ERP at some point.
Yeah.
In 2 or 3 years. So I started to think what should be the sentences we use.
Yeah.
And then I also wonder about the backbone. Would
yeah.
that be the pro? So solution
yeah, yeah, yeah,
for,
yeah.
for that question. And I see as a company that the problem is also in ERP systems, because they are not very quickly changing the formats they are using.
Yeah.
So that causes problems to companies, and for that we need quite a long time.
Yeah,
to
do that transition.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So that I feel the same, that there have to be a clear and strict and enough time to transit
yeah.
and transform. But when doing that kind of decision, one have to be very firm that
mm-hmm.
okay, it is there is the timeline, and then we move. But I think that this is very important discussion that we have to have in Finland, that how long we continue with our local formats, because I know that when we did this work, I'm coming from the company who is owning the TEAPS XML and responsible for updating it. Piri was earlier in the organization that was responsible for the FinVoice. And both of us considered that now we have quite rich EU level standard that is commonly managed and maintained, and we can contribute on that. And it's quite a big job to update these local formats. And it's also something that it's not easy for the end customers. The more syntaxes they need to consider to maintain them and so on. So that also from the syntax owner's point of view, I believe that there is definitely a readiness to make a plan to transform into the EU norm in a good and well-planned manner. But anyway, we also, I think that we consider the situation that what is the available time when we were last year in a situation that EU norm is defined and specified, and we know the deadline for when the local law has to be executed, that there is no other way to update and upgrade our existing local formats to not raise a situation that is impossible for corporates and end customers, because public sector have to be capable of handling the EU norm content, and they don't have capability to transform into the totally new syntax in a given time frame. Then you have to do the upgrade of the existing local formats, so that we can be compliant with those local formats, but at the same time raise the discussion and planning that what is our plan forward in the coming years.
Yeah, can I add? One thing was that I mean, we are using the same format for B2B and B2C.
Yeah.
If we change B2B, it is, we have to have a plan for B2B
the whole,
and B2C.
The whole game. Yeah.
The whole game.
Absolutely. But anyway, there are a number of new elements that support the new EU norm semantic model for the compliance point of view in our local formats. And there are a specific specifier or identifier, specification identifier that tells that now when using the FinVoice, when this specifier is set, this FinVoice shall be EU norm content compliant. And the very same with the TEAPS XML. It doesn't mean that when one is issuing new version of Kenwatch 3.0 or TEAPS XML 3.0, it's automatically the EU non-compliant. It's not. You can still use those formats in a manner that is not, from the content point of view, on a level of EU norm, but it enables one to create and have the content of the new standard in these syntaxes. That's very important to understand that it doesn't mandate you to go right away in EU norm content, because it's a semantic standard, semantic model standard that is in that law, and from that point of view, there is a possibility that you still continue with the lesser content, but then you are not compliant, and you have to have then also understanding that if you are using or issuing in Finland the Finvoices or TEAPS XMLs, the new versions, and your receivers are, for example, behind the PEPPOL network, that will accept later on only the PEPPOL BIS version 3, the EU norm content required content, then you have to have the content in the Finvoice or TEAPS XML in the correct level. Otherwise, it doesn't work. And the second thing is that we also find out that is very important now when doing this transition or upgrade, is that we have a more strict and more thorough validation. As Martin was speaking about the schematron validation, we have done the specification for schematron validation for Finvoice and TEAPS XML new versions against the EU norm semantic model rules, business rules. Because it's not possible to guarantee the compliance of Finvoice or TEAPS XML to be EU norm compliant just using the XML schema validation. That's not enough. You have to go into the rule-based validation. And that's the most simplest way is to do it in a schematron. And it's a common effort from the operators I would say that most common from the operators, but also banks are included to develop the validation artifact for Finvoice and TEAPS XML. And the implementation is at the moment ongoing and hopefully sometimes somebody knows perhaps now better that what is the status that are we going to have them already in June or that time frame as planned available. But the point is that the key thing is that when doing the validation, it's very important that every single service provider do the validation in the same way. Otherwise, we are in a situation that Tieto validates one way, Norda validates second way, Osuuspankki in third way, Opus Capita in fifth way, and so on. And we are still in a mess. So that the validation tools will be, the specifications are available, and the artifacts will be available for service providers, for companies, for software houses, so that our aim is that we give good tools to enhance the quality of the content of Finvoice and TEAPS XML using the new version. And there is also a good reason why to do that, but on the next slide. We have some differences in validation that are, how to say, beyond the EU norm scope. And for example, we allow in Finvoice, and Finvoice the sub-roles. The EU norm doesn't support sub-roles in an invoice line level. And then also the difference in VAT calculation. In our country practice, we have been calculated it in, from the VAT summary. And the EU norm requires that it's calculated from the lines. Then it's by definition, we end up with those two different calculation bases, small deviations in decimals. And from that point of view, our schematron is allowing both calculations. But this is something that keep in mind. It will be available, and as far as I know, it will be available for free. Why to continue with our own national syntaxes? So for our guest, our excuses and explanations. But as Piri already mentioned, one very important thing is that our local syntaxes are used both P2P and P2C. And EU norm is mainly targeted at the moment for P2P. And we need to do something to overcome this. Our existing wide practice in Finland using the local syntaxes, and in a given time frame, there is no other way. Changing to EU norm syntaxes takes time to get implemented in the ERP system, workflows, and inside. So that as we see it, that the slowest part are the applications, the ERPs and workflows and so on. It takes most time to get implemented. And then there is also some missing functionality in the EU norm that we have in our current practice. We are still using the collection invoice Kontila Square, and it's not supported in EU. One thing correct me, Martin, if I'm right or wrong, but I think that there are limitations in the EU norm when considering the trade outside EU border. So the VAT categories and so on, what and how to handle the situations when your trading party is for example, not a VAT country.
Yeah. What happens when UK has the Brexit? We have a lot of business with them.
Yeah, I think that of course, UK is not obliged to follow the directive.
Yeah. And I think the UK, they will continue to use VAT, so that would be more problematic. Has been Australia, New Zealand, and Singapore.
Yeah.
They use GST, goods and service tax.
Yeah.
With completely different category codes.
Yeah. Yeah.
In PEPPOL, there is a project now for it becomes an extension of the European norm.
Yeah.
Where these limitations is being taken out.
Yeah, because that's very important that one have to more and more be aware that we are living in one globe, and more and more companies are doing business globally, but anyway.
But is it a reason to continue with the national syntaxes?
It's one thing. The Finland is very much dependent on exporting and so on. So that the domestic, it's of course very important, but we are very dependent on doing trade outside, and from that point of view, it's very crucial that we are not facing the situation that we implement something that we are then have to implement something else to make the business with for example, outside the EU.
But is, in this case, is invoice and TIAPs?
They are capable of doing that.
Sorry?
They can be handled.
Yeah.
And
UBL,
it's and UBL can, definitely. Definitely. So that I think that this is now the question that shall there be an common extension or something in the EU norm, how it shall be used in a outside EU to make it clear, because otherwise it leads into the situations that the trade don't stop, and we find out ways how to do it, and you can be 100% sure that the ways how we do it is totally different in every single country in the EU.
This is a real challenge for Sweden.
Yeah.
The Swedish law on mandating invoices is also applied to non-Swedish suppliers.
Yeah. Okay, but a couple of things that we have in our mind. Secure invoices is now supported in new versions, and it's something that is not managed in the EU norm at all. But anyway, the conversion into the EU norm syntax requires solid planning and roadmap, that's for sure. And then my thinking on some important remarks concerning EU norm. One has to be very accurate with certain things when aiming to EU norm compliant content. And there is very heavily used different code sets in elements in EU norm. And I strongly suggest that everybody who aim to have the EU norm content in their invoices be familiar with those code sets. And they are listed in CEF pages. There is a good documentation to those, and otherwise you always lead into the situation that it's almost EU non-compliant, but the receiver just declines it because the values in the elements are not according to norm. Then the usage of scenes for parties, locations, and other identifiers. That's something that is, we haven't been familiar with that earlier in our Finnish practice. So that for example, that 037 in our OBT code and so on, it's a scheme ID. Or 007 as a Swedish organization, scheme ID, and so on. Party addressing is something that is very important to understand that how to do it. We have been used in Finland mainly the service provider information and the OVP. And that's something that is a little bit different in EU norm content. Number of different sizes for invoice usage specification. Sizes are listed in the set pages. This is as Martin shows that it leads easily in a situation that if one is supporting only one SIUS as a receiving party, then the only way to deliver for that receiver is to use their SIUS. And that's a problem because there is already now quite a number of those SIUSes, and they don't make the life easy for supplier or the company who is issuing the invoices. National SIUS and open competition. This is my complaint. So that on everything you have to keep in mind, this is not the Tieto's opinion, this is Tapan's statement, so that have to be very clear with that. And Sayus and Peppol domain-specific authority requirements seems to have an impact on open competition. And what I mean with this is that, for example, in Italy it's practically the situation that it's not possible to provide e-invoicing service without being an Italian company driven by Italian citizens and using only Italian certificates. Very simple. If you are Italian and working in an Italian company. But what it has to do with the pan-European level? Public sector pioneers shall be published in domain-specific address registers, for example, Norway and Belgium, Bosa and Elma and so on. And that's in practice somewhat problematic that leads into the situation that, for example, even a service provider that is a certified, and now I'm speaking Peppol especially, certified service provider who is not, how to say, or who's using the authority agreement, for example, outside of those two countries, and don't use the local SMBs, the registries that they normally use, they actually can't provide the service for the local authorities in those countries. They have to make the Appendix 5 domain-specific agreement with those authorities at least, and so on. In my thinking, it's somewhat that have an impact on the competition.
As I understand this, is if a Finnish service provider wants to provide services to a Norwegian public entity, for example, then you have to accept that they register in the Norwegian registry.
Yeah.
That's true. But if you provide services to a Swedish receiver, then
no. My point is that EU is not harmonized. Domains are not harmonized at the moment, and there are certain things that we need to go forward. So that we have done very good steps forward, but we are not in a final situation. But there are still limitations and restrictions, as always will be. But we need to be very open with those and concrete with those and solve them one by one. And then, for example, this is a small thing, but how the issue in invoice, for example, in Sweden's crown currency to Spain. If Spain is using their own Factura A format, it requires the euro currency also in line level. What to do? So that there are, how to say, devil is in many cases it's in the details. And there are those devils at the moment. Some remarks concerning Finland identifiers. This is mainly a very simple thing, and what I want to stress that if we really want to get the contents better and EU non-compliant, we have to start using the data elements and the contents correctly in our invoices. This is just an example that in Finland we typically use these IDs, organization ID, tyytymys, that is defined in PRO. What is the syntax? Numbers, hyphen, and the control number. Then we have a VAT number, that this is the organization number without the hyphen, and as a prefix, the country FY. And then we have organization data, I call it organization data interchange identifier, or by the tunnus. That is, I don't say totally different, but it's not an organization ID. It's a combination of organization ID and the prefix 0037, that is an international standard, and then the purpose of the OBT code has, it goes behind to, is Jari here, Jari is here. Jari knows everything about the history of the OBT code from the early OBT in the 80s, when it has been created. And it's very clever in a sense that it realized that companies have several entities. And very often there is a need to direct the receiving data flow into the different entities, into the different meals or locations and so on. And that's why in the OBT code we have five digits as a trailer behind the organization ID, to make it possible to point out that this is Jyväskylä, this is Kokkola, this is Tampere, and so on. In the e-invoicing, they don't need to be digits, they can be characters. But those are different. And what we see in the invoices at the moment, that those are mixed very easily and happily. You put the organization ID in one element where there should be a VAT code, or you put the OBT code in the organization ID place and so on. And what it then means in practice. We do clever automation and robotics in a receiver side. To fix those things, because the OBT code is in the wrong element, or the organization ID is in the wrong element, or it's written a little bit different without the hyphen or whatever. And then that's something that we put a lot of efforts and very, very, non-clever way, brain power and effort on such an automation that can be handled in a proper way when the source is and the source database is in a good shape. No need for that kind of fixing. It was easy when everything was done by manually, the receiving invoice, because human being is very clever and good in processing data. They can see it easily. Okay, this is coming in an organization ID field, but it's an OBT code. I can handle it. But when there are systems, then it's different. Don't take that this is all the thing. This is just trying to explain that how important it is that we start using the data content correctly in right fields. How to present addresses? Currently only supported Finland SIM ID in EU norm is 0037 OBT prefix. We have requested to have also the SIM IDs for Finnish VAT ID and the organization number and IBAN. IBAN was there, yeah. And IBAN is mainly used for the B2C. I don't have a strong opinion on what is the right way to publish Finnish OBT address in the EU norm. Should we put the 0037 as the SIM ID and the rest 13 characters as the endpoint ID in PEPPOL 0037 as the SIEM ID and the full OVT code in an endpoint ID. This is something that we have to actually agree between ourselves that to make it one way and communicate it in one way, but otherwise I'm 100% sure that we start using it, addressing in different ways. We are close enough, but then we have unnecessary complications to manage everything. How to manage the intermediate data, or do we need to manage it? And if we don't going to manage the intermediator data, how to address the cross-border operator connections that are not in any dynamic address resolution registry. We are now speaking quite a lot of PEP. How much of the e-invoice volumes at the moment in the EU are in PEP? 5%, very small amount. Most are in a traditional operator and interoperability networks. All of them. Still, the PEP policy is growing, but the fact of life is just keeping in mind that where the volumes at the moment are. It's very important that we can handle these situations as well. And at the moment, there is no in the EU norm syntax, there is no place for intermediator. There is a place if we use the envelope that is on top of the EU's message. But anyway, I think that the future is bright. Do you agree? Future is bright. Very good foundation to proceed and build value add on top of existing practice. And what I mean with this is that there is a lot of benefits that we can gain from the processing automation, from the e-receive, from the mobile invoice, etc., etc. But we can build on those. Let us not harm us based on crap, but instead in good quality content. From local syntaxes towards the EU standard. I think that when we do the content good in our local syntaxes, this step will be much, much easier when we transform ourselves into the EU non-level syntax. Infrastructure development, this is something that the discussion is ongoing and in future, will we have a multilateral infrastructure also in Finland instead of a bilateral operator to bank type of infrastructure? And I know that the Ministry of Finance is interested and driving that, but let's see. But keeping in mind that that's also something that is ongoing. Contribute on standards development, not just try to adapt. That's very important for us as a small nation, as a small country, and very dependent on interconnection and trade or cross-border, that we are not only adapting, but we have to be active and impact so that whatever is happening in EU level standardization, we have our fingers and our marks and our needs in there. And it's totally possible if we are taking that action. And it gives also a good basis for the bright future. Okay, I think that was the last one. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think we save the questions to the panel.